We're joined by the Minister of Aviation, Ms. Hadi Sirika. Thank you for coming on this morning.
Thank you too.
Well, we will start with the Enugu scenario, then we'll move on to other parts of what's happening in the aviation world. So give us an update, because we thought we saw some advertorial somewhere, some agitation concerning whether or not work has started in concerning the airport in Enugu. What is the latest?
Well, the latest is that work is ongoing.
Okay.
Work does not necessarily mean the movement of equipment into the airport to begin the reconstruction of that particular airport or runway. Work involves planning the work itself, mobilizing to get to work, and getting to do the actual work itself. So, and the planning is more important than the work itself, or is equally as important. For me, it's even more important, because when you plan very well, then you succeed. But if you don't plan very well, you rush to go to work.
Doesn't that happen before the closure, or it's a continuous process?
Well, yes, because this runway in particular closed itself, because it actually failed, and we kept trying to get it to function very well. It keeps failing almost on a daily basis, and we are very afraid that what happened in Port Harcourt many years ago would happen on this runway, because in Port Harcourt it was failing. And the then Ministry of Aviation is doing the best that they can and are fine to keep the runway safe. But unfortunately, one time the runway started to fold like mat, and an Air France airplane landed, damaged the landing gear, and got stuck on the runway. So it has to close itself.
What cost?
And then it took 2.5 years or so to get the runway rehabilitated and back to function.
What could that cost it?
Well, it's cyclic fatigue. Runways are, you forgot that Abuja, for example, it was designed for 20 years. And for 34 years, we did nothing until when Abuja literally shut itself. But in Abuja, we saw it. We were doing what is condition monitoring. We are monitoring that runway. And we started to plan and how we're going to rehabilitate the runway. But even that also caught us by surprise, that we have to actually close it on the 8th of March, 2017, because it actually has failed. And any further operations on that runway is totally unsafe and unacceptable, below standards. And we cannot accept that, because we cannot accept a tragedy on the runway of things that we know we could do and we didn't do. So we can't be culprits.
What could have informed not doing anything after 20 years when, it was part of the recommendation that it needed to be upgraded after 20 years or less?
Well, ask those people who were in government at the time. I have exonerated myself, because it's on record. It's on record that I have been talking about Abuja second runway, and then I wasn't minister, I wasn't member House of Reps, I wasn't senator, I was just ordinary Hadi, an aviator and a member of the aviation family, and I wrote along. Many people spoke also at that time. But government of that time, it fell on deaf ears.
So what should be done now to create that structure so that,
Well, that's what we're doing now. Every airport will have its maintenance program. Every runway would have its maintenance program, its the facility management. And then there's certain things in place now that we'll be able to do those maintenance as at when due. And if it needs total resurfacing or total reconstruction or total redesign, I will do all of that at certain preset times, either by usage or by calendar month. If you, for example, you are supposed to take 10 million cycles of landings and taking off on this particular runway, and then you go bust that, that should not be allowed. And before it happens, then there are things that you should do to improve or to bring back the life of the runway almost to zero. And this is also in every single aviation activity. Even airplanes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, sorry to butt in. Speak to the issues around the people who are supposed to be maintaining these airports, because I would look beyond the Ministry of Aviation, for instance. I would look straight to the Federal Airports Authority, the Nigeria Civil Aviation, and all of those
other... Still with the ministry.
Yes, I know, but those were systems there, that they should just do their jobs without necessarily, waiting for the minister.
No, I don't think it's a case of waiting for the minister. It's a case of the way we find ourselves in Nigeria. And I'm not being political here. I'm just saying that when we kept thinking that we should change, it does not mean that we should... it also means that we should change our attitudes and culture. and tradition and way of doing things. And I agree with you, yes, there is an entity who are the owners and custodian of those runways, and they have their own challenges also, which we're trying to sort out. One, for example, when I came in as minister, I found a very bogus and aged workforce, even in PAN itself. For example, I said that I found 45 general managers in PAN, and these general managers are level 17, and we have 22 airports. So if you divide 45, by 22, you have two average of two general managers in every airport, including Akure, Azere, Katsina, etc. You understand Calabar? You have two general managers level 17 with CAR, with the PAs, with the SAs, with everything, with the retinue office and all of their ESTA codes and so on. So it's that one is, and they have too many ways that there are leakages in terms of revenue generation. And then their capacity also to do this work dwindled. There was no training or retraining of staff at the time. I knew at the time when the ministry decided to take a certain function of FAN, which is the airfield lighting, and take it to NAMA. And then some of the engineers were transferred to NAMA from FAN, and some were retired arbitrarily. And they lost a lot of workforce in FAN at the time. I knew more than 20, 30, well-trained engineers left FAN. And there's no, and then, of course, speaks to the remuneration as a civil servant and so on and so forth. You know, and that made them to some of them to leave. But some of it was deliberate. Government just fired some of them, transferred some of them, took away some of them. So they lost capacity to be able to even handle these complex situations. Otherwise, in the fund of before, during NAA and all of those years, they can actually virtually do a project from within. They're well trained, very well educated, and they've got the experience. We have some of them now, but a lot needs to be done to improve. That's why we are paying attention to capacity building, training and retraining since I came. And of course, issues of welfare, issues of promotion, condition of service. There's so many things that are put together. You know, these are not small things. Right. Condition of service is not a small matter.
Okay, to jump in again. In that meeting, I think they also raised the question of the alternative routes, the airport, I think Owerri and Astaba. What's going on with those ones as well?
In that meeting, they raised issues of routing. Oh, I guess what you mean. When we closed Abuja, we provided alternative landing spots, which is Kaduna. And we provided at the time buses to help to cushion the effect and provide service between the two airports. We'll take you from Kaduna Airport and bring you into Abuja and vice versa through buses, which the government paid for through the Ministry of Finance. I think it's about total they paid for all those cycles of buses for those 6 weeks. It's something in the region of 300 or there about million, if I remember well. And they're saying that we should provide similar service. This is still being discussed. This is still being offered. And as regards the roads, we were lucky at the time the Abuja-Kaduna road was budgeted for repairs. So the Minister of Works and Housing was called in to accelerate the procurement for that maintenance of that runway. I mean, that road to Kaduna. It was done. And also, the governor of Kaduna did extremely very well as well. He constructed new road ahead of the time from the train station to the airport. And then he also rehabilitated the Nnamdi Azikiwe Expressway, which is a very long, I think about 27-kilometer road from the bypass all the way to Mando Junction and all the way to the airport. And then another route also from the airport through to Rugachikun, he rehabilitated by himself. And he did quite a lot of things in the town. We activated the hoteliers and people who would receive guests, which may likely come and sleep, including car hire. It's a whole lot of things. And this thing also will be the same. We discussed with the governors those things that would be done. And they sent in their demands, and the demands is receiving attention with government. We've forwarded all of the requests to government, and I'm sure that justice will be done to it. And it's a partnership between those states, the federal government, and us in the ministry. And everybody will play his role, giving the buses to take you to and from and the airport would had also been discussed with the governors. And whatever we would do as government to ensure that people, you know, the hardship is eased by those traveling to Enugu, we will.
When will it be open?
Well, when will it be open? If everything is equal, like I said, if everything is equal and if we get all of the funding immediately, we intend to open it before Christmas.
Okay, let's go to Lagos. Our colleague Kaide has got some questions for you. Kaide.
Right. Just like to shift attention. Now, we've talked about the Enugu Airport. I understand there are plans for a new airport in Ebonyi State. And then there's this big question about Nigeria Air. So I'd like to ask you, what is the state of Nigeria Air? Do you have any news? What should we be expecting in the coming days?
Well, Nigeria Air,
yes,
Nigeria Air is on course. I did say that many times that Nigeria was a population of 200 million people with also landmass of 926,766 square kilometers is indeed a country, very good candidate for an air carrier to create a hub around it and lack of capacity. Oftentimes, people complain that the price of ticket from here to England through BA is astronomical. The price is more than the price from Ghana, and Ghana is farther away by distance. Now, because we don't have any robust carrier equal to the economy of Nigeria, we suffer some of those things because there is no alternative. And then they can have a field day. Nigerians are traveling public. We've seen this quarter alone how aviation has grown by about 12.1%. The second fastest growing industry in the country as at today, as at yesterday's figures from Minister of Finance. So yes, the carrier is on course. The outline business case has been brought in by the consultants and is being looked at, and then implementation will begin soon. Would advertise and then invite people to come and partner in a PPP to produce this airline. And I believe we'll get it right this time around.
Okay, speaking of getting it right, I think one of the issues that came up after that was some controversy about the announcement and then the eventual, you know, operations of Nigeria Air. So the question is, how are you ensuring that these controversies don't come up again? And, I mean, so we can have what we aim to achieve.
Well, controversies will always come. This is normal. This is human. But our ability to deal with those controversies is much more important. And I think at the time that we need the buy-ins of stakeholders. If you remember that we invited channels, we've sat down with stakeholders in the aviation industry and even those in tangential businesses within the sector. We sat like five times to discuss our roadmap, which was well thought out. And we've discussed this and got to accept the roadmap and the plan of action to provide this airline. Unfortunately, of course, we were running towards election at the time, and so many things were happening too quickly, you know, and then we had to wait a bit to tweak those things to get it right. The question is not how very quickly we get it, but how very well we were able to achieve this particular objective of establishing a carrier.
Okay, now speaking of getting it well, I'd like to show you what, you know, some people are saying about airports in Nigeria. You know, there's this saying that you can get a country's reputation, you know, at the access point, so this time around at the airport. So this is what an airport user put up recently, just about a week ago, about the Murtala Mohammed International Airport here in Lagos. It says, beautiful place and one of the best Nigeria has, although I personally feel it could be neater. That's one user, AJ. Now, let's take a look at another review coming from RK. These are initials, by the way. Now, this is what this person says 5 days ago. Says, for a national airport and the very first place of contact for foreigners in the country, it could really be much more better than it is. Goes on to say, leaking roof, terrible customer service, baggage insecurity, extortionist custom and immigration officers, terrible waiting area, laughable pick and drop. And the person goes on and on. How do you respond to some of these things? And how? What are you doing to ensure that we have, you know, better services at the airport?
Well, I agree with you that, of course, some of these problems do exist, but we didn't sit by, did nothing. We have delivered an airport in Port Harcourt. We have delivered an airport here in Terminal Building here in Abuja. We're going to deliver one by God's grace in November in Kano. We'll deliver the new Lagos in February or March, all things being equal. And these are our own modest way of intervention. But let me just talk about this Lagos that the gentleman tweeted or sent you in message. Is that Lagos was designed and built in the late 70s and early 80s. It was designed for 200,000 people per annum. Today, Lagos is doing 8 million. It's like you having a flat of one bedroom, one kitchen, one toilet with one wife and one son. And you decide to marry four wives, bring in your aunties, your uncles and everybody, and suddenly the family becomes 200 people in that same single flat using that same toilet, one toilet. You know, you're bound to have problems. Look at Murtala Mohammed, it's on one floor. The global practice now is to put them in two floors, arrival and departure. But because Murtala is an archaic airport, it's an old airport, an airport that was built in 1980, for example, to become functional, you know, and meant to do 200,000 people, now it's doing 8 million. Nothing was added to it. You know, you expect these things to happen. You expect that certain structures will dilapidate and you continue to maintain. Literally, you have to, in that analogy I did with one house, one flat, you need to keep somebody by the bathroom so that once somebody gets in there to use it, he cleans it and come out and remain perpetually right there. And even with that, certain breakages would happen because of cyclic fatigue, because of usage, because of burdening the infrastructure. And so the story is in Nigeria. But we didn't sit idle, did nothing. We came in, we found that these airport terminals that were intended to be built by the former government at about 20-30%, you know, but we took it to completion with a record time. And we dealt with some of the issues that were there that it seemed to me at the beginning was impossible to even get that done. Okay. But we remained there, we did. And then, by the way, passengers, we're doing so many things in aviation. A passenger wants to see a nice airport, air conditioned, travelator, lift, toilet, everything. Nice teas, duty free, and what have you. That is an airport. That is an airport terminal building. I also want to see that. I am trying to achieve that. But what is more important and more critical for us in aviation is our safety and security first. What you do from point A to B, point of takeoff to point of landing, so many things happen in between and at those places. And those are our priority and our focus. And we've been spending so much time, energy, and resources to fix all of those things that happen between point A and point B. Take off and landing. You have to land safe and secure first before you enjoy all of these niceties. And we didn't abandon those comfortable things that you like to see, like the air conditioning and the travelators. But we're saying that what we're doing in aviation, for example, we've just installed low-level wind shear alert systems. And no passenger will know this. Even you as journalists, you don't know. And that is to tell you at what point and where and location and time that the air which you are riding through will tear apart in two parts and suddenly and in different directions and quickly and to cause crash like what it did to Sosoliso. We fixed that. We're putting systems in place in Ilorin, in Kaduna, in Lagos, everywhere, in Katsina even, to tell you when that wind shear will happen to save lives.
All right.
And these are so many things that we're doing. In fact, the plane has to be guided to the threshold of the runway at the center line of that runway.
All right.
And that equipment has to be there in place. So it's much more important to be safe and secure than to be fanciful, even though we haven't abandoned the fancy part.
Well, Honorable Minister, one thing that a lot of people see at the airport when they get in there, in fact, some think it's difficult to plan what you have to fly. Arrival time, takeoff time. Airlines, they have huge challenges in this country meeting up with those times. What has been done about it?
Well, we're doing something. The regulators, which is the NCAA, is doing a lot with them. One, to even improve their knowledge and the capacity and ability to do so. Two, we're encouraging the airlines also to develop capacity because some of them is capacity issues. If you have got too many routes that you operate and you have, say, for example, 10 airplanes, and then those 10 airplanes cannot serve those your routes, and you don't plan very well to have an airplane on the ground that will be ready to fill in the gap, in some cases causes delays. And delays, some of them are not man-made necessarily. They could be due to weather. You go to Europe, you go to the US, you go to everywhere, you get delays and cancellations due certain unforeseen things that like an act of force majeure, and they happen on a daily basis. An ash comes somewhere and you close the airport. But having said that, here in Nigeria, we're trying to partner with the airlines to build their capacities, to educate them, and then to encourage them to build their own capacity. Because you have to have the equipment to be able to do so. You see, it's typical of airlines, for example, to put in a route. We've seen it happen, to begin to go to, say, London or Dubai or something, and after people have bought tickets, they abandon them, they come back, and they leave them there, and crisis happens. And this is because they don't have capacity. Right here also, we see that some don't have capacity. So we're trying to say that, okay, the policy is that for you to operate in such and such a manner, you must have such and such equipment in place and minimums. You know, so we created all of that, and we're working slowly with them. It will be, unless except if it is weather-related or some mechanical faults that happen suddenly, you know, you should not be experiencing delay in the future due to incapacity. So that we can do. And then, of course, in trying to regulate these airlines, we also teach them the techniques. Because people assume that because you are a pilot, or because you are an engineer, or because you are a traffic controller, or an aviator, that you are the best aviation manager. And that is not the case. The case is you're the best aviation manager if you have the knowledge. Okay? Best airline managers are those people who actually studied businesses with a bias to aviation. So in this place that you find money bags calculating 120 passengers times 25,000 naira to Port Harcourt equals this, and that's huge sums of money. And before they know it, they come back and then they find that those numbers don't add up. You know why? Because they do not factor certain things, even in the choice of airplane that you fly from point A to B. And that's why we put the age limit to airplanes to, let's say, 20. The newer airplanes today, they consume 20% of the operational cost in fuel. But the older generation that are 20 years, they consume 40, 45%. So if you choose to bring a 20-year airplane into the country to operate, you are starting minus 20%, 25% of your operational cost, comparative to somebody who has a new airplane.
Wow. There's always a lot to talk about. We didn't even scratch the BASA agreement, the Open Skies agreement, but I think
Important. That single African air transport market is very important to be discussed.
We'll have to schedule
to understand.
We will do something about that. So we'll look through your schedule and see when that can happen, so at least people can understand more of what's going on in the sector. But we do appreciate your coming on this morning. We've been speaking with the Honorable Minister of Aviation, Hadi Sirika.
Thank you very much.